My goal is to talk about MMP. So I'm going to start with a slow introduction. And I'm sure many of you... Introduction to MMP. I'm sure many of you know this stuff very well, but I would like to start from the basics. So I should also say that I'm sure Oliver gave very, very nice lectures last week, so it's very much a challenge for me to do this, so I'll try my best. I only saw one, and I'm going to try to start from there. Okay, but from a probably very slightly different, just a slightly different point of view, I would like to talk about what is the MMP for. I'd like to talk about motivations. So I'm going to start from the case of surfaces. So I somehow gave quite a few lectures on MMPs. And I realized, my favorite way to look at MMP is looking at some special graph. So some of you probably already heard this story, and I apologize for that. So I want to construct a big graph given by looking at smooth surfaces. So more specifically, we want to construct a direct graph, which is nothing very fancy. It just means that edges have an orientation, meaning that vertices are vertices. There's nothing new, but edge, we always go from A to B. Okay, so what are my vertices? So again, I'm just focusing to surfaces for the time being. So my vertices are smooth projected surfaces. You can even drop projective, but for the time being, let's make this surfaces. Okay, so there are many, many vertices. And we want to try somehow to ordinate these surfaces. We want to try to somehow create a good order, or whatever it means to classify surfaces. So how do we do that? Well, I guess this is very natural. Given x and y, smooth projected surfaces, we say that there is an edge from x to y. If this is, so this is going to be an edge, corresponds to a branch homomorphism within x and y. Between x and y. So more excited from x to y, of course. So I should say that, I should have said before, vertices are smooth projected surface up to isomorphism. Everything I do, it's up to isomorphism. So in particular, I'm not going to consider trivial edges. For me, f would never be a trivial edge, an isomorphism. Okay, because a quotient, everything by isomorphism. So very simple stuff. If this is true, in particular, rho of x, it's always greater than rho of y. Okay, because we always contract something if it's not trivial. So that means that we are getting rid of some curves, everything smooth, so there are no problems in terms of Cartier divisors. So clearly this is true. So now the question is, okay, how do we study this big graph? I don't even know if it makes sense, but somehow I guess the idea is very clear. So clearly one property that follows immediately from that is that there are no cycles.
What do you mean with rho? The
rho of x is the dimension of the Picard number. It's the Picard number. So in other words, the dimension of the Picard of x. As I say, everything is smooth at the moment, so there's no problem. If you prefer, you can also say that B2 of x is always greater than the second topology. The second Betti number is always greater than of x is always greater than 1 of y. So what does it mean there are no cycles? First of all, let's define cycles. So, you can imagine what it is. A cycle, I'm not going to be precise, but a cycle is something like this. So there are nothing like this, because There's nothing like that, because whenever you do a step, there's always something that decreases. It will never go back high again. So one first property that follows immediately from this simple property is that there is nothing like that. Of course, there could be some, this is not allowed, but of course there could be something like that, right? This, there are plenty of this one. Okay, what else do we want to study about this graph? Well, of course, if I start from x, so you can imagine what I mean by above and below. In this notation, x is above y and y is below x, because there is an arrow from x to y. Okay, so there are infinitely many vertices above a given one. Actually, there are many, because even if you work on a finite field, I mean, we can always continue to blow up. So in other words, I can start from any surface. I suppose this is a surface. And I start to blow up points. And I continue to do it in a sequence. And I get infinitely many objects which sit on top of X. Okay, so it doesn't make any sense to study what happens on the sky. We want to see what happens on the bottom. Okay, so somehow we are interested to study what is below X. So what is below a given vertex? Okay, so one thing that also follows from this property, rho of x is always a positive number, and this is an integer, of course. So clearly, there cannot be infinite path inside this graph. Okay, below this, sorry. If you start from one vertex, x, there will be no infinite path starting from x. So let me just say it in words. Fixed x, there are no infinite paths. This is going to be crucial for what we're going to do later on. Of course, for surfaces, everything is easy. In higher dimension, all this becomes fairly complicated. So let me write it explicitly. So what does it mean? Again, I'm not going to be very precise, but you can imagine what it means. There is nothing like that. At some point, you need to stop. Okay, and again, because then this number can only decrease finitely many times. Okay, so but when do we stop? How do we know what we where we end up once we stop? So let me give a definition. An endpoint. Again, this is, I'm not sure if it's a classic thing or I just came out with it, but an endpoint in a directed graph means it's a vertex with nothing below. So what does it mean? It means that given x, it would be called an endpoint if you have nothing, no y for which there exists a path from x to y. Okay, so this is clearly, since there are, okay, there are no cycles, and there are no infinite paths below x, so given any x, there exists always an endpoint below x. And this is what we want to study. I mean, we want to study what are the endpoints. I mean, clearly they're more interesting than what happens above, because there's no way that we can study what happens above. So we want to study these graphs from this point of view. Let me say something I should have said before. Is that, of course, this graph will have many, many connected components. Sorry, I should have mentioned this before, but let me say it now. Note that if you have xy, again, projected surfaces or vertices, inside this graph, in the same connected component, then they're birational.
and vice versa. So what does it mean? If they're birational, they're in the same connected component. So there are infinitely many connected components, again, with infinitely many ugly things happening. But we know very well when two surfaces belong or not in the same same connected component. It means that they have they share an open set, a Zariski set, a Zariski non-trivial open set. Okay? So now the question is very similar to this one. How many endpoints there are in any connected component? Again, this question, I guess, makes sense. You fix one connected component, and you ask, what is below? Okay? You can also ask something a bit more specific. Given X, how many endpoints there are below X? So again, this is, in higher dimension, these are all slightly, actually, very complicated problems. Since for surfaces, everything is well understood. So let me start from the easiest example. So let's suppose that X is P2. Let's suppose that X is P2, and let's consider the connected component of X. So I'm sure all of you, or most of you, know that there are infinitely many. Endpoints. Why? Because of course P2 is an endpoint. There is nothing below P2. Okay, you cannot find any interesting map which go any interesting morphism which goes from P2 to something of the same dimension. But there is much more than that. So for instance, P2 is one, of course. But also if you take Fn, there is a book surfaces, which is the projectization of this vector band on P1, of course. I should say we need to remove n equal to 1, of course. Because otherwise it's nothing but the blow up of P2 in one point. Then these are all endpoints of this connected component. So it looks like the answer could be infinite here. Okay, let me try to understand what are these objects. Okay, before we give some answer to this question. So this is Fano. Okay, there's nothing to do about this. This is not Fano, unless n is equal to 0, but it's very close to be Fano. Oliver already talked about that. I will change the name just for what I'm used to. So they always emit, of course, a morphism to P1, for which the fiber is P1. So in particular, fiber is Fano. So I think this is what Oliver called Fano fibration, or something like that. And I will call Mori fiber space. I will talk a lot about this object. So don't worry. If it doesn't look familiar, we will talk about it a lot. But they're very precise objects. I mean, again, my role is to understand what are the endpoints. So for this example, all the endpoints are either Fano or they emit a fibration for which the general fiber is Fano. Okay. So, but again, of course, the answer is not always infinity. But sometimes it could be quite the opposite, actually. Let me see. These correspond to rational surfaces. This big object, which is the connected component representing P2, is the set of all the rational surfaces, smooth rational surfaces. Let's consider the opposite. Let's consider surfaces which are not uniruled.
So uniruled means that it's covered by a rational curve. In other words, for each point, there exists a P1 passing through that point. We're talking about something smooth, so at the moment there's not a problem about distinguishing. So let's suppose that X is not uniruled. I'm going to give you the answer. Then there is always a unique endpoint in the connector component. Okay, what is this endpoint? Let me continue here. This endpoint is what we call minimum model. Of course, it's represented by a surface. Let me call it Z. So clearly, something special. Inside this big connector component, we're assuming that X is here, there's almost nothing interesting in X. There are many, many, many surfaces, but there's one which is unique, which sits at the very, very bottom. And it's which I called Z. Okay, so clearly it needs, you ought to have a name, I mean, and we call it minimum model. So when things are rational, there are many, many endpoints, we saw. But when, in the opposite case, there is only one. So what are the properties? I'm going to talk about this a lot in general in higher dimensions, so I'm not going to give any proof at the moment. But one property that always satisfied by minimum model. So let me just say that, it follows that. KZ is NF. So this is, if you want, a property. If you have something which is uniruled, and it's a endpoint in this connected component, then always has this property that KZ is NF, which means the canonical divisor is non-negative on any curve inside Z. Okay, so let me finish the story for surfaces. I think that I said all I wanted to say by saying that there is clearly a dichotomy, two kinds of surfaces, those that look like P2 and those that are not uniruled. So, and the answer is always the same. If you start from something which is not uniruled, then there is always a unique endpoint, which we call minimum model. If X is not, sorry, is uniruled, I didn't talk about this in general, but the answer is always the same, it's the same as P2, then there exist always infinitely many endpoints. And all these have the property which emit some kind of finite fabrication. So they are all modifiable space. Okay, so one thing that you should be careful is that, again, you can consider two different kinds of problems. Either consider the whole connected component, or you can fix an X and look what is below X. If you do this, then there is only finitely many endpoints. Okay, but again, in the case of surface, it's a bit too simple, so I'm not going to talk about this too much. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, probably everything is obvious, so let me go into higher dimension. Let me talk about what happens, or what we think happens in higher dimension. But more or less, I described all the problem that I wanted to talk about in these lectures. In other words, we want to show things like, do we have, in higher dimension, do we have infinite paths? Or do we have infinitely many endpoints? or what are the endpoints? What happens if x is uniruled? What happens if x is not uniruled, and so on? All these problems are exactly the same, have the same generalization to higher dimensional varieties. Of course, they're much harder, and many of these are still very open. But let's try. I mean, let's start from describing at least the problem in higher dimension. So, first of all, it would be nice to do exactly the same thing. Meaning that it would be nice to consider projected trifolds, smooth projected trifolds, and also consider Barashian morphism within these objects. But surely, most of what I say today, just now, is not true. Meaning that it doesn't even, first of all, this one wouldn't be true, for sure. And so on. There are too many things which fail, and I'm going to talk about it in the next, today or in the next few lectures. But one thing that we immediately realize is that we cannot work with morphisms. So I should say that first, I would still construct, we want to construct a graph. Again, a direct graph. But before what I say makes sense, I need to start from the edges rather than the vertices. It makes no sense, but we try. So we start from the edges. We start to understand what the edges are. So if you were here last week, you heard, or maybe even today, I don't know, you heard words like flips, flops, and so on. So this, live in this world. I mean, we need to live with them. There is nothing we can do. We cannot stop thinking about things like flips, flops, and so on. So we need to work with objects, with morphisms which are not defined everywhere, with maps which are not defined anywhere. Okay, so we need to work with rational maps. So we need to consider rational maps. In other words, maps which are not defined everywhere. But of course, let me take a very stupid example. Everything I will say is very simple, but if you've never seen before, it might not be the right, it might not look like the right thing to do. Let me start from an example. Let's go back to surfaces. Let's consider x equal to p2, and y the blow up of p2. So clearly, you all agree that this is a rational map. But clearly you agree that this is not a very smart rational map to consider in this graph. Why? Because you start from something simple, you get into something which is less simple than x. So we want to avoid this. For surface it's easy, you just take the opposite, you take morphism. In higher dimension you need a more fancy definition. So let's start. So let phi from x to y be a, everything will be normal for the time being. X and y will be normal, we'll be assuming much more than normal. But let's suppose that x and y at the moment it's a Barashian morphism. Okay, so we want to avoid this kind of, this is a definition, sorry. We want to remove these two examples. So we'll say that phi, it's a Barashian contraction. If you think about that, this is the only way to do it. If the inverse of phi, which goes from y to x, does not contract any divisor. Maybe you're not used to the word Barashian. Let's say Barashian map, sorry. Meaning that it's not defined everywhere. Okay, so first of all, why is this well defined? Well, phi minus 1 is not defined everywhere, but nevertheless, we know that any rational map is defined on the generic point of a divisor. So it makes sense to say that it does not contract divisor. It doesn't make any sense to say it does not contract any curve or anything like that. But divisors are fine because any rational map is defined on the generic point of a divisor. So this definition makes sense.
Yep.
So contract, yes. So what does it mean, contract a divisor? Again, we can assume that everything is well defined because because phi is defined at the generic point of a curve, of a divisor. So what it means to contract is exactly what you expect, meaning that if you take a curve inside the divisor, the divisor is covered by curves. This is one way to say the divisor. For any general point, there exists a curve passing through eta in inside E, which is contracted. This is one way to do it. Contracted to a point, mapped to a point. Again, since I'm taking eta to be a general point, meaning away from a Zariski closed set, this makes sense. There are many ways to do it, but this is one way to do it. Okay, it does not mean that that x to y contracts divisor. That's the important thing. I'm not saying that we always contract a divisor when we go from x to y.
Is it the same to say that the dimension of the image of the divisor is smaller?
Yeah, that's right, yes, exactly the same.
In this sense?
Yeah, at the generic point, yes, that's right, yes. That's another way to say it, yeah. Phi of v goes into something, yeah, that's right. So phi of v has lower dimension. The closure of phi of v has lower dimension. Then E. Thank you. Okay. So this makes sense, I hope. I mean, again, I justify why we care about this. Okay, but it's not good enough. This definition is not good enough. First of all, it's not true that even if phi is a rational contraction, it's not true that phi, rho of x is greater than rho of y. But that is okay, we can live without that. But why is not enough? Because again, I'm going to construct a graph, right? This is my goal. And I don't want cycle in the graph, because if I have cycle in the graph, I cannot talk about endpoints anymore. It doesn't make any sense to say I'm going to go forward. I can go round, round, round all the time. So I really want to go forward. And I don't want to have cycles. So if you only consider rational contraction, one of the main problems is that for sure we will have to deal with cycles, which I don't want. Meaning things like this. What is an example? An example is a flop. A flop is a rational contraction. There are no divisors contracted from anything. But you can go forward and then you can anti-flop or whatever. You take the inverse of the flop. And sure, you're going to have a cycle. So I really don't want, there are many more examples, of course, but sure, I don't want anything like that. So I need to be more precise. There's also another reason. It's because I want to understand, as I said before, I'm going to work with singular varieties. So you should think of it, even from now, that x and y are singular varieties. For the time being, they're going to be normal. We're going to put more restrictions. But if I don't restrict my edges, I will not be able to restrict to nice singularities. So I need to say more. And the second one will be a little bit less natural. But I'm going to try my best to justify why it's important. OK, so for instance, we want to avoid flops. If you don't know what it means, it doesn't matter. Okay, so what do we do about that? Well, let's I'm going to give another definition. Let's assume that phi, how did I say, from x to y, it's a Brashian contraction. Then phi is called k negative, and you will see why. I mean, you can imagine what is this k, since I'm talking about flops. If, okay, so the problem here, I would like to compare the idea. Okay, let me give you the idea, then I will write down the definition. I would like to compare, since I want to avoid flops, I want to compare k of x with k of y. Okay? But how do I do that if there is not even a map, a morphism, sorry, within x and y? So I need to take some kind of resolution, at least on the indeterminacy locus, because otherwise it's hard to compare kx with ky. So if there exists a diagram like this, I guess now it's clear that what I mean with these arrows is that the morphism and with dashed arrow, they're maps. And of course, I'm assuming that this is a diagram, commutative diagram. So if you want, this is called resolution indeterminacy. Okay, let me write the definition, then I will try to justify. Such that P star of kx, so as I said, I want to compare kx with ky. Now, I don't want to have this, exactly. I want to have the opposite of this. What is the opposite of this? Well, there must be some error. So the error is what I call E. And of course, I need to give properties. So what is E? So first of all, E would be an effective divisor, but I'm going to say much more than that. It's an effective Q divisor. I forgot to say something. Okay, I'm going to do it one moment. Such that the support of V coincides with the exceptional locus. Of Q. Okay, there are a few words that you don't understand, but before I do that, let me say, I mean, this does not make any sense in general. Why? Because you cannot take a pullback of something which is not Cartier. So, fortunately for me, Oliver already mentioned this. So, I'm gonna always assume x and y are q-factorial. So remember, q-factorial means that given any divisor D, there exists an positive integer such that I'm this Cartier. Okay, if I don't assume this, I cannot take, at least not in the classic way, maybe other people can do it, but not me, I cannot take pullback. Okay, at least it's not going to be a divisor, whatever it's going to be, but not a divisor. Okay, so at least this makes sense now. Sorry, I should say more, but for the time being, let's assume that x and y are q-factorial. Okay, so what is the definition of support? You probably don't know, but E, it's a q-divisor. So we heard this word already, but E is the sum of some prime divisors with some coefficients. This is the definition of Q divisor. Of course, being effective, it just means that the AI is strictly positive. And being Q divisor means that the AI are rational, of course. The support of E is nothing but the union of the AI.
Okay, let me say a few remarks. As I said, this is not probably the most natural thing. If you saw it, it's very obvious why I do this. If you didn't see it, it's maybe not the most natural thing, but I promise that it will become more natural in the next few lectures, at least soon. Okay, first of all, there's a big, okay, I'm not going to write it. Here I'm very careful writing exist. If I write for all, it would be a mistake. I mean, it would not be the right definition. Most of the things would not be good. So I really need one particular, because I could take blow up, random blow up, and then even an isomorphism would not be satisfying this property. So I'm really careful about here saying exist rather than for all. Okay, this is not very important. What is important is that since phi is a contraction, okay, this is an easy exercise, I'm not going to prove it. It follows automatically that the exceptional locus of Q always contain the exceptional locus of P. Okay, you cannot have, sorry, yeah, that's correct. You cannot have more divisors which are contracted here, but which are not contracted here. Okay, because otherwise you have a divisor here, which does not live here. The other way around. Otherwise you have a divisor here, which does not live here. Okay, and the inverse wouldn't be, will contract this divisor. Okay, so this is an easy exercise, but I'm not going to write anything about it. The second remark is that, and this is always going to be the case, and this is also mentioned by Oliver last week, since y is q factorial, the exceptional locus must be a divisor.
It's in the notes, but I never mentioned it.
Sorry?
It's in the notes, but I never mentioned it.
No, you mentioned it.
Really?
Yeah, I'm very sure. Yeah, I was there. I was there. The last lecture. I don't remember why, but you mentioned it. Since y is q factorial. The exceptional locus, let me write, of everything. I can even define x of phi, but since I'm talking about x of q, it's always a divisor. Of course, not irreducible, but a divisor. Okay, if you want to, if you've never seen this, maybe I'm gonna, let's see how much time do I have. Well, shall I give a proof? Well, let me give a hint of this. Of the proof. So let's suppose this is not true. So assume, for instance, that this is not true. So I suppose that there exists a curve which is contracted. Now this makes sense because P is a morphism, sorry, Q is a morphism. So it makes sense to talk about contraction of a curve. So clearly I'm working on projective varieties. So there are many, many divisors, and in particular there exists H such that H times C is positive. Okay, clearly I can do that. For instance, take any ample divisor on Y, on W, sorry. Okay. Consider F star of H. Since Y is Q factorial, Q star of H, sorry. Since Y is Q factorial, this is Q Cartier. Okay, so I can take, the image is always defined, even if it's not Q factorial. I can always take a divisor and map it to Y. There's nothing wrong about that. So this is well defined anyway. But being Q Cartier follows from the fact that it's Q factorial.
okay, take the pullback of this Couquartier device, which makes sense because it's Couquartier. And you will see that the only way that, since the only curve, since there is no divisor contracted, there is only this curve, these two divisors must be the same. But clearly there's something wrong here, because h times c is positive, and this cannot be positive on something coming from below. Okay, I'm skipping the details, but this is the idea. So it's never going to be a curve, just a curve. And the same proof works if you say something with Chiskov dimension greater than 1. So it's always going to be a divisor. So it makes sense to talk about exceptional locus of Q as a divisor. And as I say, from now on, we always, okay, let me write this. So first of all, any question with this definition or anything? Okay, let me say something. Let's assume now, we will assume that varieties in the graph are cofactorial. At least those in the graph. I'm going to make more restriction, but for the time being, I'm going to say that I will never talk about things which are not Couquartier. I should say that this is convenient, but of course convenient, I could choose anything smooth and it would be convenient as well. But it's also, I'm allowed to do that. The good thing about the minimum of the program is that if you start with something which is cofactorial, you will always end up with something which is cofactorial. So I'm really not cheating by doing that. Of course, I'm going to talk about it much more, but the idea is that by doing this, I don't lose anything. Okay? I can always live in this world. Okay. Okay, so let's consider these varieties. So, okay, we define what are k-negative morph is gone. Sorry, flops are not k-negative. This is easy to check. Flop are not k-negative bilateral contraction. Clearly, they're bilateral contraction, but not k-negative, because for a flop, e would be equal to 0. Okay, so clearly, flops are out of the way. So it's possible, let me write. Now we can define the edges. Which is a bit funny, because I didn't define the vertices yet. But for the time being, I'm considering all the vertices, all the possible normal projective varieties which are q-factorial. So, like before, so an edge corresponds to a, so I'm sorry, it's going to be confusing because here I use this line here, not because this is an edge and this is going to be a map. It's a map, it's a k-negative, this is a definition. It's a k-negative bilateral contraction. Okay? So I'm forcing every edge to be of this way. Okay, so far so good. Let me say the first remark. You can try to do it as an exercise. Maybe it's not easy exercise, but it will become easier later on. So one good news is that with this choice, there are no cycles. Okay, so we're not going to go into a loop. We're going to go always straight. The idea is because the singularity always gets better somehow, and so you cannot force yourself into a loop. Okay, X will never be an isomorphism unless you really take the identity. I mean, you're never going to compose guys of this form and get to something which is an isomorphism. Okay, so this is the good news. The bad news is that We have no idea whether there are infinite paths. I mean, I could start working, like Oliver said last week, I could start working on this path and I would never arrive to destination. Even now, this is an open problem. But we're going to talk about this a lot. So for the time being, let's leave it as it is. Because I haven't defined what are the axes, what are the vertices. Yep.
The composition of two edges is...
It's an edge, yes, that's right. Yes. Yeah, that's right. It might be convenient to use resolution singularities because you might want to end up in something which is, resolved. But for this statement, probably not. But in general, no, actually no, because you just take the crush of the graph. No, actually no, I take it back, no. Okay, so what are the vertices? The good news, vertices are easy to define. I mean, it took me a while to define edges, but vertices are very easy to define. So X is called terminal. If there exists y smooth above x. What does it mean? You need to be careful because this is not the definition that you find in books, but it's going to be equivalent, of course. So, in other words, let me write. So I'm just repeating what I say, so I don't need to spend much time. K negative rational contraction. Okay, so you probably agree with me that this is a good definition of a vertex, right? I mean, of a singularity. You want in your connected components something smooth, at the very least. Here you definitely need resolution singularity. So let me say that now, many results are true in general, but let me work with C for the time being. If you look, many of you probably saw the definition of terminal, and it's not this one. So it's an exercise, and I solved this exercise in my notes, which you don't have, but I solved it. I will give it to you very soon. Show that this coincides with the usual definition terminal. Of course, if you never heard of definition terminal, you cannot do this exercise. But okay, I'm going to say what is the usual definition terminal. So usual definition terminal just means that same as here, but this is a proper morphism. It's well defined everywhere. Everything's in my note. I never heard of terminal. You can completely forget about this exercise because it's not going to bother you. It's going to bother you only if you already saw the definition. This is not the definition you had in mind. Okay, very good. So now we can talk about vertices. And since I already... mentioned, but I want to emphasize this is important, will be always cofactorial about terminal varieties. Of a fixed dimension, of course. I mean, not that it's important, but, well, of course there will be completely different connected components, so I don't even need to write it. But, of course, usually we fix the dimension and then we take a graph. It's already big enough, so let's fix the dimension. Okay, so most of what I said before still makes sense, right? You can still talk about connected components, and actually X and Y are in the same connected component. If and only if they're rational. So our goal is somehow to study projective varieties. I would like to say the word classify, maybe it's too much. But we would like to study rational geometry by looking at this object, okay? So what we do is to focus on one connector component, and we see what is inside this connector component. There will be many, many objects in this connector component, but what we care about is what happens below. I don't care about what happens above because there is no way to answer this question, okay? So the good news is that there are no cycles. It's gone. Oh, there are no cycles. But one open question I can tell you immediately. I'm going to talk about this a lot. But one open question is, does there exist, given X, does there exist infinite path below X? If the answer is yes, you agree with me that at some point, you need, since there are no cycles, again, you need to stop. You need to arrive to some nice model. Okay? Okay, so let me give more properties. So, sorry, this is called termination. This kind of problem is called termination. And as I said, I'm going to talk a lot about this problem. But for a moment, let me leave it like it is. So you can imagine what is my goal. Goal is to study endpoints.
So
now,
is it clear that if and y are birational, they're in the same?
Yeah. Because you can always resolve singularity. I mean, they're terminal. So you can always assume it's smooth, and then you can always resolve singularities in such a way that it's true. Yeah, by factorization, yeah, definitely is true. I mean, if X and Y, okay, if you throw away every singular varieties, then being K negative comes for free. Okay, if you have a morphism, proper morphism, being K negative is for free. So by taking a resolution, you can always assume that you can focus on projective, smooth projective varieties, and so definitely you can assume that, yes. Okay, what is my goal is to study endpoints. How many there are? First of all, are there any endpoints? If there are, how many there are? And what are they? So let me write them. I'll do how many? First of all, do they exist? How many? What are they? You can imagine that the answer for the second question is, at the very least, it depends. Because if it depends for surfaces, clearly it must depend on the case of higher dimension varieties. But the answer is pretty much the same, at least conjecturally. So let me not talk about this now. Let me start from the last question. So unfortunately, I don't have time to do this exercise. Again, it's in my notes, which you don't have. What are they? Assume that Kx is an F. Show that X is an endpoint. Okay, so the main, actually maybe I didn't even solve it, but I'll give you the hint how to solve it. The main point is to use something called the negativity lemma, negativity of contraction. So it's not completely trivial, but it's definitely true. Okay, so what does it mean? I didn't answer, of course I didn't answer this question, right? But I gave you some many examples of endpoints. Because we know a lot of varieties which have kx to be an f. So all the varieties for which kx is an f satisfy this property. Okay, any question? Okay, let me say what I'm going to, some of the things I'm going to talk about. Some interesting problem about this kind of stuff and some answer to these questions. So first of all, okay, where do we start? There are two kinds of varieties. families of varieties, of course. Exactly like in the case of surfaces. It's exactly the same, at least conjecture. Well, maybe, let me say conjecture. So actually, this is a theorem which we're going to prove in the next few lectures. If X is uniruled, then there is always an endpoint. Below X. Okay, so this is always true. And what is, actually, we can say even more. So let me say moreover. X is a modified space. Again, this is very similar to what Oliver mentioned last time, but let me rephrase it. There exists, sorry, not X. There exists an endpoint Y, and Y is an endpoint. There exists Y to Z, which is a fabrication. So like Oliver said, fabrication means fibers are connected. Such that the dimension Z is never birational. So Z is not a point. Don't think of Z to be a point in the graph. Just think of some extra property of Y. The dimension of Z is always less than the dimension of X, which is equal to the dimension of Y, of course. This is not an interesting property. The interesting property is that the general fiber is final. Okay? So if you remember, we talk about something like that for the case of surfaces. For the case of surfaces, this coincides with P1 bundles. Of course, these are more complicated than P1 bundles because P1 is rigid. Final varieties in general have a family, have a modulized, well, they deform, sorry. So clearly we need to allow singular fibers and so on, even if Y is smooth. But still, it's very similar to what happened in the case of surfaces. Okay, so what are the other families? So this is one family. There's a big family which corresponds to the case when X is uniruled. And the second case, the quadratic dimension of X is positive. In other words, H0 of X, MKX, is positive for some, sorry, it's not the quadratic dimension is non-negative. So in other words, H0 of X, MKX is positive for some M positive. So if this is true, then, so this is a conjecture. Then X emits a minimum model, which means which is an endpoint. And automatically, KY is NF. So for this reason, Y is called minimum model. Okay, so I should say that in dimension 3, everything I say is right. But okay, one thing that is even more important, this property is a birational property. In other words, if you restrict yourself to the same connecting component, if it's true for one, it would be true for all the other in the same connecting component. So the conjecture is there is no other family. So that's it. What does it mean? It means that either X is uniruled, or what I wrote here is true. This is a big conjecture. Again, it's true in dimension 3, but it's far, far from being known in higher dimension. So in other words, there could be a family which is not a metamedia model or whatever, I don't know, and is not of this kind, is not uniruled, for which we know nothing about.
conjecture is not that then there exists a minimal model.
Yeah, there exists. Then X emits Y, which means Y exists.
Ah, okay, this is the conjecture.
This is the conjecture, yes. That's right. No, it's surely not unique. Sorry, it's it could be finite. Maybe that's the right question, but it's never unique. Oh no, sorry, never unique is too strong. But surely we know many examples for which it's not unique, because there are flops. So flops, two varieties which are which have, I mean, two minimal models which are connected by flops, might not be isomorphic. So, but okay, there is a family for which we know that it's finite. And this family, so this is also a theorem which I'm going to talk about. If kx is big, so I'm running out of time, so let me just remind very fast what it means. It means that mkx, it's a almost like a polynomial, which has a maximum degree. You know what it means. I mean, it means that the amount of section is maximal with respect of the dimension. Okay, then X emits a minimal model. Okay, so this is okay. And it's finite, and there are finite in many, and there are most finite in many. So again, you can, since what is written here is that endpoints are minimal and vice versa, this is the vice versa, so you can either ask if there are finitely many endpoints or there are finitely many minimal models, it's exactly the same question. Okay, so I'm already running out of time. Let me say something very briefly. Again, I wrote in the notes. For surfaces, I should have said at the very beginning, I don't care about singularities because every terminal singularity in dimension 2 is smooth. Okay? So here we need to work with singularities because it's very easy to start with something which is smooth, but then by running this game, you're not going to end up in, I mean, there is no interesting endpoint within the smooth varieties. So the graph will be too hard to study. So one of the things we realized a long time ago was that, I mean, this is in the 80s, or even before that, is that we are forced to work with singularities. And that somehow this is the right, I mean, we believe that this is the right picture. This is the right graph of varieties that we want to look at. Okay, thanks very much.